A production of Prairie Public Classic.
None of a wildlife species can exist in an area that is dominated by leafy spurge. Without native grass, you might as well shut the park down.
It's not going to go away today, tomorrow, or in the near future.
So we need to do something soon, or it's going to be taking over. We won't have any grazing land left.
Production funding is made possible by Team Leafy Spurge, an area-wide program of the United States Department of Agriculture, Agricultural Research Service, and by the members of Prairie Public Broadcasting.
Come here, girls. Come on. Come on. Go.
Sharon Jensen and her husband Dean have been raising elk on a small ranch near Wheatland, North Dakota for the past 12 years. It's been their lifelong dream to successfully raise a unique and value-added commodity. But in the past 3 years, Leafy Spurge has been trying to take over their pasture land and put this value-added herd out of business. And this noxious weed has been winning.
As you can see, we don't have any grass left in our pasture because the spurge is taking over. And every year it's getting noticeably worse. So we need to do something soon or it's going to be taking over. We won't have any grazing land left.
For the past 3 years, the Jensens have seen an alarming change in their pastures. The lush native grasses that once grew in abundance throughout their farm are quickly being pushed out by an aggressive foreign invader, leafy spurge. These invasive weeds crop up as a small, rather innocuous green and yellow patch along a fence line or hillside. Now the colorful spurge is taking over and threatening the survival of the Jensen's elk raising operation.
We have 80 head as of today. Elk are very particular in what they eat. There's not much leaves on it, it's mostly the flower that's on top, so I think they probably don't like that.
The Jensens are one of thousands of ranchers and land managers across North America that are fighting a difficult struggle against exotic, invasive weeds. The term weed has been used to describe any plant that is unwanted and grows or spreads aggressively. Exotic weeds have long been called ecological bandits or wildflowers from hell. For decades, these aggressive foreign-born plants have been creeping into the fields, rangeland, and roadsides across the continent.
Any introduced species, or a species that was never originally in this particular area, once they're introduced, if they don't have any natural controls, the problem is that they will use up precious resources.
In the late 1800s, leafy spurge was identified as a rare plant in North America. In the 1920s, it was discovered that leafy spurge was not a native plant, but a foreign invader. Today, leafy spurge has since become a nemesis for farmers and ranchers across most of Canada and 35 states. Spurge invades grazing lands, reducing the production of desirable plants, decreasing rangeland plant diversity, degrading wildlife habitat, and reducing land values. Spurge infestations in Wyoming, Montana, South Dakota, and North Dakota are estimated to cost producers and taxpayers more than $144 million annually. The United States national parks, reserves, and state lands have long been a haven for wildlife and native plant communities, but the explosion of leafy spurge and other noxious weeds across our parks' grasslands threaten to permanently alter the ecology of these protected regions.
By the time we got into 1986, there were over 400 acres of spurge. 16 years or so, it had grown to that much. And then once it started growing, it just starts doubling at a rate every 10 years. Right now, up until the last couple of years, we talked about having 4,000 acres of spurge here in the South Unit. Leafy spurge is a real pretty plant. In fact, if you look at a lot of postcards that's sold of a park or photos taken of a park, you see leafy spurge in them. If unchecked, leafy spurge will take over every acre that native grass is growing on. Without native grass, you might as well shut the park down.
For decades, efforts to control these noxious weeds have been difficult and in many ways unsuccessful. The use of herbicides, tilling, and burning have produced limited results. Rough terrain, dry conditions, and ecological concerns have also limited noxious weed control.
We don't care what they do other than take out the spurge.
But recently, researchers and land managers have started an integrated pest management program. IPM is designed to use all available control tools independently or in combination to control leafy spurge. The Ecological Area-Wide Management of Leafy Spurge, or Team Leafy Spurge, is a 6-year program funded by the USDA, the Agricultural Research Service, and managed cooperatively with the USDA's Animal and Plant Health Inspection Service. This public and private partnership of researchers, agribusinesses, farmers, and land managers hope to develop an integrated pest management program that will purge spurge from the upper Great Plains.
Okay, this one I want you to take a close look at. This is probably the first time.
The way this plant got to our country might have been through avenues of importation of cold hardy grains, and a lot of those grains came from Eastern Europe, and the abilities to clean those seeds were not as good as they are now. You can picture seeds of a plant like this coming in and actually drilled into the ground with the grains.
It moved over here into a setting that's very similar to where it was growing.
Roger Myers' family homesteaded near Medora, North Dakota in 1909. This cattle ranch, centered in the middle of the Badlands, has been prosperous, benefiting from the natural forage that thrives on the range. For the past 30 years, the Myers Ranch has fought the noxious weed, leafy spurge.
It's been kind of hit and miss. I'd spray for a while, then get discouraged, then spray again, and then get discouraged. And I really haven't had much success with the spray.
Spurge is not selective when it spreads. The hardy spurge seed can hitch a ride in a load of hay or on a car bumper or passed on to new sites by grazing animals and birds. No one is sure how it migrated onto the Myers fields and grazing lands. The same riddle holds true for the neighboring Theodore Roosevelt National Park near Medora, North Dakota. The spurge scourge is a serious problem in several national parks in 11 northern states.
When it starts growing, it's such a dominant invasive species that it will crowd out all of the native vegetation that grows in an area. Without the native vegetation, then the wildlife moves out of that area. The bison, the elk, the deer, none of the wildlife species can exist in an area that is dominated by leafy spurge. So that's the reason that we're concerned about it.
Not only are terrestrial wildlife impacted by invasives, but exotic weeds like purple loosestrife, thistle, and leafy spurge can damage a variety of land and water habitats.
They actually can change the ecology of the land in which they're invading. For instance, changing the ecology of a stream channel or changing the ecology of a lake so that it cannot support the type of habitat that would normally exist there, it starts to impact them negatively.
Leafy spurge reproduces readily by seeds and vegetative buds. In mid to late summer, each spurge plant withers and dries up, causing the seed capsule to explode, dispersing seeds up to 15 feet from the parent plant. Water and wildlife can also carry its seed capsules further. The seed has a high germination rate, and the tough outer shell preserves the seed, keeping it viable in the soil up to a decade.
You often see early infestations of leafy spurge where you see these round colonies on the hillsides, and that's the result of the plant of an individual plant getting established by whatever means, and then that plant producing seed and raining out seed in a radial pattern.
The weed's root system is complex and can extend 15 feet or more into the ground.
If you were to come in here, for example, and say you wanted to try to get rid of this plant by cultivating it out, if you were to chop those roots up, very small sections of those roots dragged along will simply produce new plants wherever they land.
Spurge poses a major problem for ranchers and public land managers because of its ability to spread rapidly. Its deep roots sustain the weed under repeated chemical treatments.
It'll take over all the grass area if it's not controlled, and that's all you'll have. And as you can see, some of this here is now done blooming. It isn't a nice weed. If you walk through it, there's a milky substance there, really sticky. I mean, it's not, you know, cattle won't eat it.
See, if you break the stem, see that sap that runs out of it? That real white sap? Well, that is a real toxic sap. And if the anemones eat it, it gets inside their mouth and it burns them.
When eaten, leafy spurge can cause ulcers in the esophagus of horses and cattle. Once exposed to spurge, these animals will avoid spurge and the grass growing near the domineering weed. According to agricultural experts, the number of acres currently taken over by leafy spurge would support 90,000 head of cattle in the four-state region of the Dakotas, Montana, and Wyoming. That means a loss of about $37 million in annual livestock sales and a total economic impact of $120 million each year to the cattle industry.
Your lands, the public lands that we're talking about, if they are invaded by a noxious weed, it costs a tremendous amount of money and resources and time in order to control those weeds. And again, that comes out of your pocket.
When I got out of college in 1960, our spurge was just small scattered patches, and I had the idea that I was going to spray it and kill it. Well, I sprayed a lot for about 5 years, then I got discouraged and quit spraying for a few more years, and then the spurge really exploded. Spurge was increasing faster than I was able to spray it down, and so I got discouraged and decided, well, I'm just going to live with it, I guess.
Leafy spurge also had an adverse impact on wildlife habitat as well. In the Theodore Roosevelt National Park, spurge has reduced the value of the park's wildlife habitat.
When it blooms, it looks kind of nice, but I mean, you can see what happens in nature when you bring in a foreign species into the environment and there's no natural predators to control it.
It's a weed that we don't want to see in that area because it outcompetes the native vegetation. And then it's also one that's really aggressive and really invasive and tends to take over and dominate.
The damage extends further once leafy spurge takes over. With little edible vegetation, wildlife moves into remote parts of the park that haven't been impacted by spurge, or they leave the park completely.
When the wildlife moves out, then not only do we have less habitat for the wildlife, but the opportunities that people have for viewing wildlife decreases. Most of our road system, such as the one before us, follows the rivers and the streams and stuff. If that's all in leafy spurge, then the visitors are not going to see the native wildlife.
Because it really ruins the native wildlife and the fauna and, you know, the flora. And if the public were aware of it, they would perhaps help in supporting efforts to remove it.
Fishermen, fisherwomen, hunters, bird watchers, anybody who uses the sites could spread the weeds, but they could also help be part of the solution.
Concerted efforts to find an effective method of control and reduce spurge didn't begin until the 1940s.
This is tordon at 2 quarts per acre.
Since then, researchers, farmers, ranchers, and land managers have been using one or a combination of controls to purge spurge.
Once a plant is established in terms of cultivating, you're not really going to catch up with the plant or diminish its viability.
Efforts to discover a suitable control method for leafy spurge on this continent began in the 40s and 50s. While chemical control efforts have affected the distribution and the rate of spread of leafy spurge, chemical costs continue to rise, and the process has proven ineffective in providing sustained long-term control.
The plant has come here without any natural enemies. So it's got really a leg up in terms of growing and producing. As aggressive as it is, without anything working on it, it's just really had its way with the rangelands and farmlands in the upper Midwest.
United States Department of Agriculture researchers and cooperating universities started making extensive studies of the life cycle and ecology of leafy spurge in the 1960s. In 1988, researchers discover that the aphthonoth flea beetle held promise. The larvae of this black flea beetle feed on the root system of leafy spurge.
Can it handle different soil types? Can it handle North Dakota winters? You want these insects to show up here and do a bang-up job on this spurge.
But the biggest problem, there were not enough flea beetles to go around. Like leafy spurge, the aphthonoth flea beetle is native to the European continent. They didn't exist in North America, so researchers worked with farmers and ranchers to raise their own.
We like to look to see if we can see the flea beetles. They're about the size of a pinhead, but they're just a little bitty beetle, and then when you touch them, they hop kind of like a grasshopper.
A large-scale field rearing and release program was established in eastern North Dakota from the initial release of 80 insects. Since then, hundreds of millions of flea beetles have been collected and moved to hundreds of thousands of sites in more than 20 states.
So far we've found that we've got pretty good establishment of the flea beetles, and the establishment means that we can see craters, essentially, or areas of control of leafy spurge.
I think probably 3 years ago we might have had 1,000 acres that was infested so heavily with spurge that there were almost no grass in that 1,000 acres. And now I think I might have reduced that by 80 to 90%.
Biological controls, such as insects, will not completely erase spurge from the landscape. However, if leafy spurge is reduced to about 5% of its original outbreak, it becomes a manageable part of the ecological and economic landscape.
It's not going to go away today, tomorrow, or in the near future. Probably the best return that I can say that we will have on our particular program is a lot of the lessons learned in controlling leafy spurge. Not only integrating all of the tools, bringing them all together, but also integrating all the players.
Unlike cattle and horses, goats and sheep are able to forage on leafy spurge. In fact, recent research shows the density of leafy spurge can be reduced by as much as 50% in 3 years through sheep and goat grazing. North Dakota State University studies also show that allowing sheep to graze on spurge with cattle, followed by a fall application of herbicide, provides more effective spurge control than either control method used alone. Grazing is being used in conjunction with insects. A grazing study near Sentinel Butte, North Dakota, utilizes a mix of flea beetles, sheep, and cattle to reclaim a square mile of spurge-infested grassland. In this multi-species grazing, the sheep are released into the pasture side by side with the cattle.
Really, the research goes back into the 1930s that said that sheep did utilize leafy spurge and cattle did not, but at that time the magnitude of the problem wasn't as large as it is today, and now we're just bringing it back to the surface and showing how we can put cattle and sheep together to still keep the beef cattle rancher in business. When we first bring the cattle out in the very first day, they will graze spurge and eat it, and then they quit and they never graze spurge again. We bring the sheep out and they start and they actually increase their enthusiasm for grazing spurge.
A major cost for multi-species grazing is the expense of upgrading fences to contain the sheep. The larger the spurge stands and pastures, the lower the fencing costs per acre. Chemical herbicides continue to be one of the primary tools in the integrated pest management plan to control leafy spurge.
Now, this particular infestation is so thick that the biological agents haven't been able to establish in here. So this is an ideal location for the herbicide-insect interaction, where we can go in and thin out a stand and then hopefully get the biological control agents to establish and spread out from here.
From a rancher's perspective, success is the removal of a pest like leafy spurge to increase more desirable forage for the herd. While federal and state land managers want the same goal, they are required to maintain and improve grasslands to meet a variety of public uses. More progressive weed management districts use an integrated management spurge plan.
One of our primary objectives of Team Leafy Spurge is that once we developed the scientific information, then we had to have a mechanism that transferred it over to other public land managers or to the private rancher or farmer. And so that's been a real effort and one we've really concentrated on.
While biological controls offer a highly promising management tool for leafy spurge, experts say it is not the total solution. A successful weed control program requires a well-planned strategy with consistent and timely follow-through. That's why the best solution for controlling any invasive weed like leafy spurge is an integrated pest management or IPM plan. A successful biologically based IPM program requires the integration of a number of control tools. Officials at Theodore Roosevelt National Park in Medora, North Dakota, saw large blocks of land where spurge was contained and reduced to acceptable levels by large numbers of insect biological control agents.
This confluence that you see right over my shoulder is a confluence of Knutson Creek and the Little Missouri River, an ideal space for spurge to get a foothold and to start growing. And as recent as 1985 and 86, it was a mass of yellow out there. If you would look across the landscape when the spurge was blooming. In 97, we started an aerial application of plateau to knock the spurge back. Then we also got some biocontrol insects, the flea beetles, on the site to eat the spurge as it started to come back from the herbicide treatment. So today you see what you have out there right now, very little yellow, except back underneath some of the taller trees. What we have learned through Team Leafy Spurge efforts, research as well as the demonstration sites, if you use herbicide alone, in order to control and contain leafy spurge, you're going to have to be out every year spraying that herbicide. And year after year after year, not only is that expensive, but it's also time consuming. And something where if you start skipping a year or two, then you've lost everything you've gained on it. We have found that an integrated weed management approach is the best way to go. Use the herbicide to punch leafy spurge, to knock it down, to set it back, and then come in immediately behind the herbicide, put in large quantities of the flea beetles, and then let the flea beetle population build up so that then they are the one that control the leafy spurge.
By using an integrated pest management, or IPM program, ranchers and land managers can use proven strategies for effective, affordable, and sustainable leafy spurge control. A variety of tools are available that can be combined to control the spread of spurge. Herbicides are a preferred tool for containing and preventing the spread of spurge infestations. Biological controls using flea beetles provides economical and ecological spurge control that can be sustained. Diversifying cattle grazing operations with sheep or goats provides multi-species grazing for leafy spurge control. Cultural and mechanical controls, such as reseeding, clipping, and burning, can be used to give desirable grasses and plants a competitive edge while reducing spurge's dominance.
You can't eradicate leafy spurge once it gets established. What you can do is contain it, and that's our objective, is that we just want to get leafy spurge down to an acceptable level of where it's 2 to 3% of a landscape.
Exotic invaders like leafy spurge can rapidly displace native vegetation in a variety of habitats and fields, stealing water, plant food, and sunlight from nearby plants. They are aggressive invaders and, once present in your fields, can completely overtake large areas of open land. If left unchecked, exotic weeds will rob nutrients from the land and reduce quality habitat and forage needed by cattle and wildlife. These factors erode land values, reduce revenue, and increase taxes. 55% of the nation's total land area consists of publicly or privately owned range, pasture, and forage lands. The grazing and forages these lands provide are the foundation of the forage livestock industry, with its 60 million beef and dairy cattle and 8 million sheep that contributes more than $60 billion in farm sales each year. In addition, they produce annually approximately $11 billion in hay crop that is the third most valuable crop after corn and soybeans. Invasive and noxious weeds like leafy spurge can have a devastating effect on our national grasslands. Proper land management is key in controlling spurge in the future. The director of Nature Conservancy's Wildland Invasive Species Team, John Randall, says while farmers, ranchers, and land managers are the nation's first line defense, it's vital that private citizens, communities, and public service groups lend a hand in preserving the nation's grasslands.
Folks can prevent weeds from invading by cleaning off their clothes and their vehicles. They can clean off the other gear that they bring into sites. And if they spot a new infestation, they can let the land managers know about it. Everybody bears responsibility for managing invasive species, invasive weeds like leafy spurge.
Until a final solution is found, noxious weeds like leafy spurge will have to be carefully and diligently managed to protect our grasslands. The accomplishments of Team Leafy Spurge proves invasive weeds can be effectively managed. Take the time and the responsibility to visit your favorite park or reserve. Find out what you or your service group can offer to keep our national grasslands healthy and productive for generations to come. Production funding is made possible by Team Leafy Spurge, an area-wide program of the United States Department of Agriculture, Agricultural Research Service, and by the members of Prairie Public Broadcasting.
A production of Prairie Public Television.